Okay. Ladies and gentlemen, I'd like to introduce to you Peter Joosten, and he will be talking about biotechnology hacking into life. So please give it up for Peter Joosten.
The U.S. Navy SEALs. They had a problem a couple of years ago because their soldiers were walking through the desert, and then in the distance they could see the enemy, not you, but behind you. And they were very tired, and then they had to make a sprint and get a good aim. And they thought, how can you do that while your heart rhythm is very high, and then you have to be focused to unleash a good shot? And then they found, well, we can look at new technology to help us, or maybe we can also use old technology. And they actually found out that they could use an old yoga breathing. In English, it's called the box breathing, where you breathe in via your nose for 4 seconds, then you hold for 4 seconds, then out for 4 seconds, and then hold for 4 seconds, like a box. And I also use it right now before I get on stage. It helps me to get more relaxed and focused and inside the flow. So I would like to start my presentation with the box breathing. So sit tight, breathe out via your mouth, and now in, two, three, four, hold, two, three, four, out, two, three, four, hold, two, three, four. You can also try it before going to bed, like 4 or 5 of these cycles. And this is an example, a mild example of biohacking. Biohacking is about optimizing your performance. It can be as light as doing meditation. It's also something for Dimitri, maybe, doing breathing exercises or other things. But I also will explain during my presentation more invasive ways of biohacking. As Dimitri already introduced myself, my name is Peter Joosten. I give talks and lectures about the impact of technology on mankind, and I was also featured in different media, for example, the Men's Health. And maybe you know the Men's Health, and you must believe me, I really tried, but I did not make it to the cover of the Men's Health yet. But during my presentation, I can also explain to you why that is the case. And I'm also partly cyborg because a couple of years ago, there's a tiny NFC chip installed in my left hand. And I use it to put my contact information on it. And I use it for my, I also have my Bitcoin wallet on it for a while, at least my public key. So being on a hacker conference, I must be aware that you're not near my hand anytime soon. But I think this is also a future application where technology is getting smaller and smaller, and in a way we will also use it inside of our body. I would like to start with a small exercise as a kind of warming up, although the room is pretty warm in itself. And to give you a small introduction, a couple of months ago, I got a phone call from an editor of a radio program, and they asked me if I could join them in the studio that evening. And he said, well, it's for the program called Met het oog op morgen, for the Dutch people. And I said, well, I don't know. And then he said, well, if I sing something, you will notice, you will know it. It's a gute nacht, vrienden. Es wird Zeit für mich zu gehen. I see some heads nodding. And what I really liked is that the presenter of that evening was Wilfried de Jong. He's a bald guy, but he's really into sports, and he's my favorite hero. He's a really good interviewer. And he's also my favorite because, like a couple of years before, he made a program with Matthijs van Nieuwkerk called Holland Sport. And in Holland Sport, there was a quiz. And we are doing a quiz right now. So if you all please stand up. I'm going to do a quiz. I give you a couple of options. And when you have the wrong answer, you're going to sit down. Yeah, you can all join. Don't sit. And the winner of the quiz will win my book. I published a book called Biohacking. Dimitri has already read it, so if you want to know, yes, you can see it's very good. I also have some couple editions with me, so if you're not one of the winners, well, you can just buy it from me at a discount. And also, if you made a mistake, please be aware, because the themes in the questions, they come back later in my presentation. The first question is, this is Angelina Jolie, and in 2016 she got divorced. And my question is, from who did she divorce? Is it A, Matthew McConaughey, B, George Clooney, or C, Brad Pitt? So I like you, if you want to raise your hand if you think it's A, Matthew McConaughey. Now raise your hand if you think it's B, it's George Clooney. And now please raise your hand if you think C, it's Brad Pitt. 2016. Well, the good answer is C, Brad Pitt. I think everybody is still into the game. Next question. There was a famous hacker who was interviewed for magazine Wired, and he said, if I was young today, I would not be hacking into computers, but I would be hacking into life. The question is, what was the name of this hacker? Is it A, Wozniak? Is it B, Gates? Is it C, Jobs? Or is it D, Modderman? So is it A, Wozniak? B, Gates? C, Jobs? Or D, Modderman? Well, the good answer is Gates, B. So there are two people. That was a dividing question. Next, this is a clip. Well, this is from Black Mirror. The question is, what's the name of this episode? Is it A, The Entire History of You? Or is it B, Bandersnatch? So place your hands if you think it's The Entire History of You. And who says B, Bandersnatch? Well, you both go on to the following question, because indeed the answer is The Entire History of You. Garry Kasparov, he lost against Deep Blue in 1997. And the question is, in 2014, there was a film made of this event. And the question is, what's the name of the film? Is it A, Checkmate, or B, Man versus the Machine? So raise your hand if you think it's A, is it Checkmate, and B, if you think it's Man versus the Machine. Well, the good answer is B, Man versus the Machine. So congratulations. I also had one other question, but that comes another time. Two questions, but maybe for next year, if Dimitri wants me on stage again. So I want to talk about biology. This is another kind of hacking, as you might notice. And I will start with DNA. In almost every cell of your body, there are 3 billion base pairs containing 36 chromosomes, and they make about 25,000 genes. And DNA is like, is where all the information is of your heredity. And then from the DNA, a copy is made, it's called RNA, and that RNA is processed by the ribosome to make all kinds of amino acids. Well, you can forget about all that. What you must remember, or can remember, is that you can see DNA as like the operating system of life. It defines the buildup, the maintenance, and also the destruction of your cells and also your tissues and organs, etc. And the concept of heredity, it already was found out by a monk in Hungary, but for a while, about in the 16 or 1700s, but it took them really long before they knew where the information was, which was passed on from generation to generation. And these two guys, Francis Crick and James Watson, they also won the Nobel Prize because they found out that the information of DNA is contained in the famous, now famous, double helix structure. And your base code, the 3.2 billion ACTGs, they are called the genotype. And if you are curious what the influence is of your genotype on your phenotype, and your phenotype is how you look and how you behave, you just have to look at identical twins. And then you see what they have in common, in expression, in behavior. And that's what you can say is the influence of your genotype on your phenotype. And we know more and more about the analysis of DNA. This is a famous example where in 2000 the Human Genome Project was announced, where the whole full genome of a human is being sequenced. And the cost of that project was about $3 billion. And right now you can have your full body genome done for about $1,000. And this is a price decrease which even surpasses the law of Moore, and it's called the Carlson curve, where it's going way faster than the law of Moore. And you can use DNA analysis for all kinds of purposes. For example, that I did not make it to the cover of the Men's Health is based of, actually it's the fault of my parents. Because you get your half of your DNA from your father and half of your DNA from your mother. And I did a DNA test where I found out that I'm like, the straw-like person instead of being very muscular. And it's also being used in healthcare. And that's why I brought up Angelina Jolie. Because in 2013, she found out that in the female side of her family there was a lot of breast cancer, and she also did her genome tested, and she also found out that she had a mutation on the BRCA1 gene, which stands for an increased risk of also developing breast cancer. And it's also being linked to behavior. A couple of weeks ago I was at the paroles office to give a lecture, I must say, and they are also interested in, is there a relationship between certain genes and criminal behavior or violence, etc. So we know more and more about genes. And also commercial parties are leveraging this idea. For example, Nestle is making diets based on DNA. There are assessment bureaus which use DNA. You can do relationships, Tinder based on DNA, for example. So this is going really, really fast. And it's also being used by the previous speaker, and also Edwin also talked about cops. They are also using DNA. And this is a famous example of the Golden State Killer. What's so interesting about this story is they got a DNA sample of the crime scene, but they could not match it to their criminal records. And then there was one policeman who thought, well, I just can try one of these websites for heredity. So he put in the gene in that website, and then they found out on the website that he had a far cousin and a grandfather. And then they make up the family tree, and they came up with two persons that could be the Golden State Killer. And this is really true. They went to his house, they went into his garbage bin, and they collected some of his DNA, and then they found out, the police, that he really was the Golden State Killer. In the Netherlands, we also had such a case with Nicky Verstappen, as I remember. So also, the police are using DNA more and more often. But what if we not only can analyze DNA, but we can also change and alter it? And that's already the case. We can, altering or changing DNA is what we as mankind are doing like forever with crops and also with pets, for example. But in 2014, this lady with her colleague, Emmanuel Charpentier, this is Jennifer Doudna, they published an article in Nature, which was really like an explosion in the scientific community and especially in the biological sciences, because they published a research on CRISPR-Cas9. And what's mostly interesting about CRISPR-Cas9 is that it's actually a mechanism that bacteria use to defend themselves against viruses. What's really interesting is that a virus is a bacteria has a nucleus, has a cell, but a virus is actually a strand of DNA. And you can compare it, if this is like a factory and we are a bacteria, a virus is nothing more and nothing less than a paper coming in with the text, "Please copy me." And then one of the workers in the factory says, "Okay, I have to copy you," and then goes to the copying machine and makes all the copies. That's really how a virus works. So bacteria, they of course do not like viruses. So they come up with a mechanism where they have like a portrait gallery of all the well-known viruses that could attack them. And then when they see a picture and they see, oh, that's the virus coming in, they're going to attack us. And that's called the CRISPR mechanism. And Doudna and Charpentier, they actually found out that they can also program this mechanism. So they came up with the CRISPR-Cas phenomenon. And that leads to an increase in the use of biotechnology. Does anyone know this animal? Yes, very good. Dolly the sheep. She's now in Edinburgh at a museum. She was born in 1996. She was the first cloned animal. And biotechnology, the definition of biotechnology is the production of goods, services, and knowledge with actually the use of living organisms or living cells. And biotechnology in itself is, as I envision it, is becoming more and more a greater industry and also an enormous impact on our lives. And not only cloning, but we can also see the development of biotechnology compared to your specialism, as I would say, that for example, instead of zeros and ones, we have ACGG. And instead of using programming code C++, which I think is a programming code, we use CRISPR-Cas9. And instead of having backups, what's really interesting about DNA is that it has their redundancy in itself, because the double helix is it's a copy of itself. Instead of having an operating system in every cell, there are ribosomes, which also function as a kind of operating system. And that also leads some of the experts in this field to think of this development as the new computer technology. It's called synthetic biology is becoming the next IT industry. Here's what investors need to know, because we can now really program life, as you might say. And one of the most extravagant and important persons in this field is this guy, George Church. He's also one of the pioneers in genetic research, and he's the driving force in synthetic biology. And synthetic biology, it kind of looks like biotechnology, where you make, design, or redesign cells, living organisms, tissues, etc. Just as the same way as you are making software programs or other IT code using. And what's interesting, what can we do with we are actually able to program or reprogram or redesign life, to redesign organisms. To give you a couple of examples, we can think about healthcare, we can think about biofuels, for example, but there are a lot of examples. This was in the news like 2 weeks ago, where actually the photosynthesis in plants is actually pretty crappy, and they used genetic modification to increase the photosynthesis of tobacco plants. So we can also increase, for example, also the if certain crops can withstand heat or cold or drought, etc. So this could be an interesting application for agriculture. And I also give talks at government agencies, and they say, well, what do we have to do with biotech? Well, this is an interesting example. This is a company called Glowy. It's from France. And they say they are modifying moss. I don't know what's the English word for moss. With a coloring effect, like light in the dark effect. And they say, well, maybe in the future we don't need industrial lighting in the city, but maybe we can use these kinds of devices, these kinds of nature to actually enlighten the city. And it sometimes goes a little bit freaky. This was also in the news in November, where there was international an agreement that we would not use CRISPR-Cas to edit humans, especially not embryos. But then a Chinese scientist, Zhang Kuhe, he came into the news because he announced that he was the first one to bring onto this world the first genetically modified human. And I think that like in 500 years or 1,000 years, when we look back at the history, we will see, we will think that like 2018, 2019 is like a watershed moment in the evolution of mankind. Because now for the first time we actually took, you might say, evolution in our own hands. And I don't know where this is going. I'm coming back to this later. And this was also very interesting. There was a documentary on ITFA Festival where there are scientists now looking to bring back the holy mammoth. So maybe we can use synthetic biology or biotechnology to bring back extinct species. So there is a lot of questions. And I'm wondering, I give you some examples. Please look at your neighbor, and I give you one minute to discuss with each other what makes you most excited. So I give you 1 minute, and after 30 seconds I say it's 30 seconds. So what makes you most excited? Ready, go. Van de voorbeelden die je net hebt gezien. Oké. Okay. 30 seconds. All right, I start with you. Because you want to bring back the dinosaur, right?
Tyrannosaurus Rex.
You were discussing, what were you? You were, I heard, superhuman?
You could create some AI, big blob of brains.
organic, interesting. Yeah, and you, what came up at your discussion?
Well, exciting, it depends on
terrifying.
Terrifying or exciting, like good. And terrifying is more the dinosaurs. We all know the films, the movies, and agricultural is the, I think, the exciting good thing.
Okay. And what about you guys?
I was wondering if I could clone myself, so I would like make a worker of me.
Oh.
And do two things. Yeah. So one goes to work. And
the other way.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah.
Yeah. Can I also ask you guys?
Yeah, I was thinking about the humans.
can we bring back people already died, good and maybe also bad people? What would happen? Interesting discussion, I think.
Yeah, we had a discussion about bringing back Hitler, and could we steer him to good?
Oh, interesting experiment. And torture him. All right. Well, I come back on the superhuman part, because that's the definition of biohacking. What if we really are able to upgrade our cells, our human bodies, us as a species? And I would start with the Jetson fallacy. And the Jetson fallacy is a term coined by Professor Michael Best, who looked at science fiction films and books and series. And he said, what's most remarkable when we think about the future, just like in the series of Jetsons, we think that there was a series that was made in 1962, because the company already had the Flintstones, where the family was living in the past, and it was pretty successful. And then they thought, well, we can also make them in the future. But what's interesting about this series, and you can also see it in other science fiction, is that they live in the future. They fly in cars and robot maid, and everything is awesome. But they, as humans, they are still the same. And the family dynamic is still the same. It's just like nothing happened. The same with all the Star Trek. Of course, you have Borgs, etc. But humans are just humans like us. And he says the Jetson fallacy is that maybe we have flying cars and self-driving cars and drones and blockchain and smart blockchain, whatever. But we probably also will use technology to change ourselves. And that's called the Jetson fallacy. And a lot of famous thinkers, they also warned for this. Stephen Hawking also wrote about it in his last book, that he was afraid that there will be superhumans that are able to upgrade themselves with genetic modification and other application, maybe also use electronic parts instead of organic parts. And then you have the normal people. Yuval Noah Harari also wrote the book Homo Deus as a distinction with Homo sapiens. And also wrote N by Psi EI convergence, which means that people also think there will be a convergence of different technologies called neuro, bio, cogno, and info convergence. And if you combine it all together, there will be superhumans which has like super cognitive abilities, physical abilities. They will live way longer. I had an interview like a couple of months ago with Aubrey Gray, and he's one of the most prominent anti-aging scientists in the world. And he said a couple of years ago, the first person to become 1,000 years has already been born. So think about the future where that possibly be happening. So I'm curious, what kind of superhuman are you? And this is kind of a test. I want you all to stand up again. Sorry. Keep you busy. And this is a small poll actually done at the ARC Fusion dinner. It's a meeting of transhumanists. And people had to choose how far they wanted to go. So first is pretty minimal. Maybe use an activity tracker. Maybe second level is where you use a daily pill to increase your IQ. The third one is when you use genetically modified stem cells in your brain to increase your IQ. Four is that you replace your normal limbs with artificial ones for more speed and endurance. And last one is the wet dream of every transhumanist, to upgrade your mind into the cloud so you can live forever in a virtual space. So who thinks, who will start with minimal? Who thinks minimal is enough? You, then you can sit down. All right, who says daily pill to increase your IQ? Who will stop there? You, okay, you can also sit down. Who says, who will want the genetically modified stem cells to increase their IQ? Who would do that and stop there? Okay, that's you, you can sit down. All right, we have some condescending. Who says, okay, I want to replace my normal limbs for artificial limbs for more speed and endurance? Okay, you can also sit down. So we have five people who wants to upload their minds to live forever. Can I ask you? Oh, you can sit down. Yeah, sorry. You would like to live forever in the virtual world?
Yeah, well, there's a... I'd be very interested to see what we come up with, what we still can discover. I'm a very curious person of nature. Yeah, I'm just too curious to die, basically. So if I could live forever, I'd be happy. Yeah.
Yeah. I also want the other side of the spectrum. You three guys in the back, you said, well, minimal is enough. So Jan-Martijn.
Yeah, I don't like the idea to tamper with myself. So.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's enough.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's enough.
Yeah. Also for you.
Yeah, it's like inheritance, just passing over to the next gen. Like it's okay if we all grew out to be 1,000 years old. But what will happen to like the small place we live in?
Mm, yeah, yeah. Well, thanks for your responses. The last part of my presentation is on the dark side. So we come back to genetics, we come back to DNA, we come back to our genotype, as you might say. And let's start with just having DNA or your genetic information. There was an article on The Verge. Why a DNA data breach is much, much worse than a credit card leak. And that's because the major reason is that you can change the code of your credit card, you can change your bank account, you can change, but your DNA is set. You cannot change your DNA. So what if people use it and sell it to an insurance company or maybe as a kind of ransom? So that's also maybe the next generation of hackers will also be very interested in DNA. And I have some other examples of that later on. And that also the biocrime prophecy, which is a vision by Mark Goodman and Andrew Hessel. They say, well, what if biotechnology is like IT was in 1979 or 1980? And with computer technology, we had awesome things, email and the internet, etc. But we also, of course, like in the previous talks you heard about it, we also have criminals. And what if criminals will also use biotech? And why not? Of course, we use technology for the good, but also for the bad. And they had some applications. They say, what about biological spam? For example, what if you're heavily invested in a stock of a pharmaceutical company and then you modify a certain virus, which gets a lot of people ill? They buy all the products of the pharmaceutical company, and that way the stock goes up and then you sell all your stocks. So biological spam might be a future opportunity for these criminals. Another one is a biological DDoS attack. What if you genetically modify a virus and you let it loose for an employees of a certain company or maybe at a military operation somewhere? And the first example is identity theft. And I have an example of an artist, and I need to give you this context in advance, otherwise you would not get a grip of what you're seeing. But what she did, it's for example, I don't know, maybe Ewald drunk of this, but what she did, she would collect the DNA sample of what he drank, and then she reconstructs the face of, in this case, Ewald. And she did it just by walking in a city and collecting cigarettes and chewing gum, etc. And it's really spooky. I show you a short clip.
Stranger Visions is meant to provoke questions about privacy and surveillance. A lot of people who have seen the work are concerned. They wonder, what if I dropped that cigarette butter? What if that was my piece of hair and now I'm a face of the gallery? What else might that mean? And of course, this piece is meant to provoke these kinds of questions.
The work of her name is Heather DeWay Hackborg, if you're interested. And now you think, well, Peter, that's a little bit sci-fi. Well, The question is if that's the case, because Obama in 2008, Ronald Kessler, he was a former member of the Secret Service of the United States and one of the involved also in protecting President Obama at the time. He wrote in his book that everywhere the president came, for example, when he would came here, the whole the room was cleaned of his DNA. So no bed sheets, no glasses, no nothing. And also in WikiLeaks, it was claimed that Hillary Clinton in 2010 declared to all the embassies, US embassies all over the world, if they got a high ranking official from a country, to collect the DNA of these high ranking officials. So now you think, well, why would they do that? Well, for one, think about if the political opponent of Obama gets a grip of his DNA, and then they found out that he's like genetically prone to have a certain disease or something. You can see the headlines in the media. And another more dystopian vision is that there are people say maybe you can also make your biological terror weapon, which is only works on one type of DNA, in this case the President of the United States, which of course you cannot defend at all. Well, that's pretty dystopian, but actually the Secret Service and Hillary Clinton are declaring these types of pre-measurements. So I hope I gave you a good introduction into DNA, RNA, genetics. We also talked about the age of biotech in synthetic biology. We had about the superhumans and biohacking and about the dark sides of all these kinds of developments. And to conclude, I think that like Hacker Hotel is awesome, but in like 5 years or 10 years, we not only have like computer hacking spaces, but maybe Dimitri will also have a wet lab. For example, I am also now doing education in biotech, because biotechnology is coming just like normal technology, normal IT technology. So I hope if you have to remember one thing from my presentation, is that the 20th century was the age of information technology, and the 21st century will be the age of biotechnology. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Peter. We still have some time for some questions because you are well on time. So I see a question here in the front.
Yeah, so we told you where we stand. Where do you stand with regards to how far do you feel we could go?
I think if you remember the lines, I think I will stop at genetically modified stem cells in my brain. So at the moment I'm too gehecht, what's gehecht in het Engels? Attached to my normal legs and arms. So I think I would stop there. Yeah. Other questions? Pas op. Oh, ging iets te hoog. Hij was iets lichter dan ik had gedacht.
Last time we had something about biohacking on Hacker Hotel. I remember it was illegal to modify DNA. There was some science kit that could do Z-meal from potatoes, but that doing that stuff was illegal because it's modifying DNA. That still something because they did genetically modify the baby? Is this something that they had to adjust modify the law first, or?
Well, the genetically baby case is also illegal in China, because that's, but in Europe, and there's also a lot of criticism from scientists working in biology in Europe, it's there was a legislation last June, I think. It's not allowed, you're not allowed to use CRISPR besides of doing science. In Europe, but in like the United States, these laws are more relaxed. And there's also a guy, which I did not tell, but he's the Josiah Zehner, he's the CIO of the Odin, and the Odin is a biohacker company. So you can actually buy CRISPR-Cas sets at his company for like 70 euros. You can do CRISPR-Cas modifications. So you can also buy it and do it at your home and not tell anything about it. But he also made some publicity because in a Facebook Live video, he injected himself with CRISPR-Cas. And his aim was to kick out the myostatin. And myostatin is also a biological process which also Belgian dikpilkoeien. Well, cows with very muscular asses, they have the same mechanism. And he thought, if I modify myself, I could also become very muscular. But for him, it did not work. And some also think it's more like a publicity stunt. But in the summary, the restrictions on using this technology are in Europe pretty tight. And in US and China, they're more relaxed.
Kan je wat meer vertellen over wat je zeg maar nu zou kunnen doen met want je hebt dus net gezegd van je kunt een pakketje kopen maar wat you can buy a package what can you do with at the moment with it?
Well, for example, the CRISPR-Cas kit you can buy at the Odin. You can as I might should say it correctly, you have a certain kind of bacteria and then you get a gene from a jellyfish which has also glow-in-the-dark capabilities, and you eject that gene into the bacteria, and then also the bacteria is going to give light in the dark. So you can think of these kinds of developments if you want to do it at home. And he also has released a kit in which you can grow a frog extensively, but I did not test it for myself, and I don't know if you can ship that product also to Europe. So, but you can try it for yourself.
Okay, thank you. Please give it up for Peter.